Nicola Coughlan, you co-star in Bridgerton as Penelope Featherington, but spoiler alert for anyone watching this who hasn't seen the whole season yet, because I want to discuss everything that happens. So everyone pause here and come back when you're done. Okay, because what's revealed at the end of the season is that Penelope is also Lady Whistledown, who is publishing gossip about high society throughout the series. What's your approach to playing a character like Penelope, who has this hidden dimension that the audience doesn't quite know about at first?
It's really fascinating. It's such a fun challenge because it was a real balancing act in season one of going, you know, because it was talked about whether they would reveal it or not. I personally think it was the right decision because, you know, it'd be quite anticlimactic to finish, you know, season one and go on Google and find out that way. So I thought the reveal, I was like, it's actually a perfect time because also then going forward, the audience know you're in on the secret and you get to go with her on this journey. But she's fascinating because she's such a ball of contradictions in that she is the most low status person in any room and also the highest status person because she controls everything. So it's like in season one, I thought a lot about how she didn't, I think, understand the depth of her power and what she could do. And I think she sort of played with fire and you saw that she wasn't really ready, I think, for the consequences of her actions. But it's so much fun to play her in such challenge.
And might your approach to playing her change at all in coming seasons now that the audience knows, you know, that sort of the audience is in on her secret? Will that change kind of the performance, the character in terms of your approach?
I mean, absolutely. I think one of the most important things that I've been thinking about is, you know, the fact that she's at such a changeable age. She goes from 17 to 18, which, you know, that's a huge leap in anyone's life, really, because you're sort of officially an adult, I guess. But also she's lost her father in mysterious circumstances. She's gotten involved in the situation with her cousin, Marina, that she was, you know, she was the bad person in that situation. And I think she carries a lot of guilt from that and knowing what she did. So I think she's had to grow up really quite quickly. So I think you'll see that in her. And also then, you know, people getting to maybe see more of the Whistledown side of her. And I think I always think of Whistledown as sort of a drag persona in a sense, the way that drag queens talk about themselves, you know, that they have their own person and then Lady Whistledown is this and she's this and she's this. It's the same person, but I think those two sort of live together within her. So yeah, getting to balance that out. Also, she knows the marriage market now. She kind of knows what she's getting into. I think you'll definitely see her a little bit more confident. She's still Penelope, but she's definitely developing and growing.
And you know, what's it like having as that persona Julie Andrews be that voice of that side of your character?
I mean, it's phenomenal. I always say to people if they ask me what my job is, I say I job share with Julie Andrews. You know, like when I found out it was her, they had said to us, we have someone iconic for the voice. And my brain absolutely did not stretch that far. That just, I didn't even occur to me. And when I found out, I just cried because I thought, this is such a special thing. Not only am I lucky enough to be on this show, to have the role I have, then there's Julie Andrews. It's like the icing on the cake. It was just, it's still baffling to me, honestly.
And had you read the books to prepare for the show to get kind of inspiration for your approach to Penelope?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, prior to my audition, I think I had like 2 days to prepare and I just got some sides. I didn't get a full script. So, you know, with any audition, you just make a choice and take your chances and you hope for the best. And then when I got the role, I couldn't believe it. And then I went back and started reading and each Bridgerton book, as with each season of the show, focuses on a different set of characters. So the book that is predominantly about Penelope is book 4. So I went and read that first, but she's 28 in book 4 and she's only 17 in season 1. So I was like, okay, I see where she is there. I see how she is in the scripts. Let's plant seeds, but let's let her grow to that point. And it's fun. It's great. It's having that source material as an actor is invaluable. It's wonderful because it helps to enrich your performance. Even if it's things you don't see on screen, it's stuff that you know and that will, you know, maybe pay dividends later on. Yeah, you're very lucky when you have that.
And speaking of lucky, the show has been successful enough that it's actually already been renewed through season 4. So you know you're going to get to grow with Penelope all that time. How is it to kind of chart the course of one character from like these formative years of her life from 17 to 28 like that?
It's a gift. It's amazing because I think also it's the advantage of television that you're given the time in which to do that. And also the directors that we work with, like Julianne Robinson and Tom Verica, they really let you play. And I think there's often a misunderstanding, like I've often played characters a lot younger than I am, and I think people can make the mistake sometimes of not making a joke out of it, but not understanding, you know, teenagers, they're people too, and you need to treat them with respect. And a lot of the time we're still the same people, but we just have different ways of dealing with things. So it was part of me, you know, having to sort of switch off the adult side of my brain and not judge her for making silly decisions of going, she's a 17-year-old kid. She doesn't know any better. Also, she's 17 in 1813, in which she's had no proper education. She has no agency to do anything with her life. So this is how she's making these decisions. She doesn't know any better. But it's interesting to, you know, to get that chance to grow up with her, and you know, the hopes that you would have as an outsider going, I'd just like you to be a bit more confident. I'd just like you to have this. Getting to hopefully go on that journey is, yeah, it's a really special thing.
And I think she's doing quite well given the circumstances that she's in this incredibly wild family, the Featheringtons. You know, her mother, Polly Walker, you know, who is amazing.
She's the best.
And
She's so wonderful.
like, what's that family dynamic like, creating that kind of that often wild, outlandish dynamic between those family members?
It's so much fun. We were talking about it. We were saying it's funny because I get to film scenes sometimes with all of the Bridgertons and with the Featheringtons, and the tones of the houses are so different. You know, the Bridgerton, it's all light and fun, and there's always cake everywhere. And then the Featherington house, there's always something bad going on. There's always a fight and always sort of. But it's so much fun to, because Polly Walker is someone who, they always say the nicest people play the best meanies, and it's so true for her because she's just the loveliest person, but plays that ice queen so brilliantly. And I think there was a lot, I thought about it a lot, and I was like, you know, Whistledown doesn't come out of nowhere. She's heard these snarky conversations, and I think a lot of it is inspired by Portia Featherington. You know, she hears a lot of this stuff, and she's still a Featherington at heart. She's not a perfect angel, Penelope. So yeah.
And part of you know, the visual appeal of the show is the costume design, which is not only, you know, we see a lot of, you know, shows set in the past with extravagant costumes, but the use of color on this show, I think, is especially impressive and striking. What's it like working on, you know, kind of Penelope's look with the costume department and developing that aspect of her personality?
Well, it was like nothing I'd ever experienced before, to be honest, because I think a lot of the time on shows, you'll go in and a lot of the pieces are rented and put together, and you can, of course, create wonderful looks that way. But on Bridgerton, literally everything was custom. My first costume fitting, I didn't get it. There was, you know, just they were draping fabrics and sort of saying, you know, and there's a big part of the books at which, you know, Penelope's always dressed in yellow and she doesn't want to at all. She doesn't want to look like that. But Portia Featherington says, you know, happy girls dress in happy colors. So she thinks if her daughters are really garish, they'll secure a husband quicker. And I think there was a fearlessness to the way that Ella Marajnik designed this show, and that she went, we're not doing historically accurate. We don't care about that. This is Bridgerton. This is a world we're creating. So she's like, there's no bonnets in this world. And she was inspired by, you know, runway collections and Versace and Miu Miu. And I think it's what gave the show such a distinctive look and feel. And it felt like we read the rule book, but sort of threw it out the window. And it's amazing the way people have responded to that.
And building a character where you're in this period setting, but there are also these, you know, out of time kind of touches, you know, not just in the costumes but in the soundtrack. Is that you know, complex as an actor, where you're sort of in a certain time but kind of out of time at the same time?
Well, what was funny, we didn't know what the music was going to be. So when we danced, we would dance to contemporary music, but not the one which you hear on the show. Like, we only heard that, I think we got copies of the show about a month prior to its actual release. And then the music would start playing and you go, okay, I know that song, but why would I know string quartet? And then you go, it's Ariana Grande. Oh my God. And then you go, oh, that's the perfect thing because it really describes what the whole world of Bridgerton is. You think you know what it is, it's classic, but then it's got such a twist to it. So, I mean, I love the music. But then now I think we're all probably annoying Chris Van Dusen with going, well, I heard this string quartet version of this song and I think it would be really good. But I do think I found a couple of good ones, honestly. So we'll see what he says.
One of my favorite relationships on the show is between Penelope and Eloise. This really warm friendship they have, complex friendship they have, conflicts. What was that relationship like to develop with Claudia Jessi and creating that bond, but also kind of that clash when they're at odds?
It was really wonderful. I mean, I say it all the time, but I couldn't wish for a better person to play that partnership with, because Claudia is so open and wonderful and so willing to play. And I think when you have that trust between actors, that's when you can create really amazing moments, because you go, well, I'm going to try this and see what you do. And she's really responsive and does just brilliant, brilliant things. I think, you know, the writing of those two characters is excellent as well, because they feel like real young women going through issues. They're very relatable. And they're also just this perfect balance between each other, the real yin and yang, you know, together, where, you know, Eloise is this extrovert, Penelope's an introvert. And they truly love each other. You can feel the love there. And, you know, again, I'm so lucky that Claudia and I do get on so well. But also, you know, there, you can see the way, you know, it happens in friendships when someone is sort of progressing this way and someone's still here or going this way. And it's the clash that they have where, you know, Penelope has all these stresses of being out in society and all this stuff. And that's where their conflict comes from. But, you know, it's true. I think it's what happens in friendships. It's not always sunshine and roses. And I, you know, we hated filming that because we were like, we don't want them not to get on. You know, it always feels like it hurts when they're mad at each other. But yeah, it just made them feel rounded and real. And in this world that's so lavish and beautiful and over the top, there's these really grounded, brilliant human characters, and it's just so fun to play.
Yeah, it is always hard to see character, especially characters when you are love both characters, to see
Yeah.
them in conflict with each other is
Oh,
always
hate
one of the
it.
hardest things to do in
Yeah.
watching a show or a movie, like the two people you want to get along the most.
Oh, yeah.
And it's sort of that way a little bit with Penelope and Marina, because they are
Yeah.
both also outsiders in a way, where they should be allies, and yet Penelope's crush on Colin makes
I know.
that incredibly complex. What were those emotional scenes like to film, where Penelope is really at her lowest and is trying to just kind of get through, this growing up process and learning, the ropes of these older people who are trying to teach her what the world is?
Well, I think it's such an interesting period of history in that, you know, you go from being a child to immediately you're a young woman, you're of marriageable age, you need to be out in society. And she's interesting because she's such a child in certain ways, but then she's also very smart. That doesn't mean she has street smarts or that she's wise to these things. And I think that can hamper in certain ways that she thinks she knows stuff, but realistically, she's not had the experience. And I think she's very excited by Marina. And Marina represents, you know, kind of freedom. And she has all these stories. And Penelope loves to listen to her stories. And I think she thinks they're going to be bosom buddies and it's all going to go great. And then it all just goes sort of horribly wrong. And, you know, Penelope acts, you know, really badly in that situation. But then she does it out of love and out of protection. And there's a definite certain amount of selfishness to it, too. But yeah, that was hard. Like sometimes, you know, playing something like that can take a toll because there's parts of times where you go, she's so lonely. She's so alone and she doesn't really let anybody in. Even Eloise obviously doesn't know her biggest secret. So she just, I always think she puts things in boxes and puts them on a shelf. But I think eventually the shelf will collapse under the weight of all those secrets. And, you know, yeah, I worry for her. If I was her friend, I'd be like, you need to go to therapy and just talk it out and it will all be better.
And the show has such a large cast of characters, and you all were nominated for a SAG Award
Yes.
for Best Ensemble Cast. What's it like being recognized, not just like an award for your performance specifically, but an award as a team, as a cast?
That meant so much. It meant so much because being recognized by your peers is such a huge thing. And, you know, the quality of actors on the show, like, they're people that I had admired their careers way before being cast with them on Bridgerton, like Jonathan Bailey and Polly Walker, who I'd seen in so much stuff. And Kelly Hendry, the casting director, put together a group of people that were not the obvious choices, were complex actors who had done theatre, who'd done lots of different things, that came from lots of different backgrounds. And for people to recognise that ensemble working together to create this piece, and it really does feel like that. It feels like a family. That was, yeah, it was such a wonderful thing and super unexpected. I was on a walk with my sister, and I got a text from, we have a Bridgerton text group, and so we've been nominated, and I thought, oh my God, I didn't expect it. It was an amazing, amazing feeling.
And, you know, with such a big cast, and, you know, back in, I believe you're back shooting season two currently.
Yes.
How is it obviously different under the world circumstances? The COVID, you know, pandemic has struck, and obviously being in physical spaces with other people has changed so much. Like, how is that different this season?
Yeah, it's very different. So I mean, there's a lot of testing. It's sort of like getting up at 4 a.m. and immediately having a COVID test is not, you know, maybe most people's idea of fun. But I always say it's a real testament to how much you love your job, that you're like, I will subject myself to that as much as I need to in order to be at work. And I think, you know, the people that have come back from season two, like especially the crew, you know, everyone that came back really wants to be there and knows what it entails, because it's hard work making Bridgerton, because it's a mammoth show. It's like making 8 movies. So the hours are ridiculous. The costumes can be uncomfortable, but we just love it. And I think you really feel that energy. And then having the new actors in too has been very exciting, because, you know, you want to be like, you know, welcome into the family and this is what we do. And it's going to be crazy and we're very tired, but it'll be really fun. And, you know, yeah.
Well, congratulations on the show, the first season, second, third, fourth seasons to come. You know, get swabbed hair,
yes,
corseted, all of it together.
Corset, little shoes, all of it. It's all worth it.
You know, thank you so much for talking to me about the show. It's been a pleasure.
My pleasure, Daniel. Thank you.